It's good morning.
Yes, sir.
Good morning, all of you. Good morning, students. Good morning, principals, PGTs, PGTs, and good morning, all the viewers who are watching this session. Now we have the webinar session from the subject Commerce and Accountancy, Intermediate Second Year, and the topic is Banking and Insurance Services. In the today's session, we are going to learn about the e-banking and the insurance services, like meaning and definition of insurance, types of insurance, functions of insurance, and especially about insurance regulatory and development authority. And more you will know from the subject teacher. And this session is going to be handled by N. Shailaja, PGT Commerce, from TSMS Mirdoddi, Siddipet district. So I request all the students to listen the session carefully. This is very important topic. The weightage of this unit for your IP is 17 marks, and the task of this final last session will be followed. And please follow the session carefully. Now over to Shailaja madam.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, principal ma'am, sirs, and my dear students. A hearty welcome to today's webinar session. So in the previous session, we have introduced the second unit and we have completed till functions of banking. So today we are going to learn about e-banking services and insurance services, which is a continuation of the second unit of business services unit. Okay, now let us see the contents of today's session first. So in today's session, we are going to learn about e-banking, features of i-banking, that is internet banking, advantages of e-banking, limitations of e-banking, meaning and definition of insurance, features of insurance, types of insurance, fire insurance policies, life insurance policies, marine insurance policies, IRDA, composition, duties and powers of IRDA. Now let us start the session with the e-banking. So the scheduled banks in the country have to strictly follow the RBI norms. Okay, therefore all banks are equal in competition in attracting the new customers and retaining the existing customers. They have to find out ways and means to improve their services by adopting the new technology and value added services to their customers so that they can keep pace in the competition and succeed in the competition by rendering value added services to their customers. So e-banking is one such segment which is introduced by private banks. Okay, the concept of e-banking enables the customer to transact with his bank from anywhere and then any time by use of Wi-Fi. Okay, so e-banking is a system of banking which is carried out with the use of electronic tools and facilitated through electronic delivery channels. These services are rendered to the customers at low cost and without any geographical barriers. Okay, so they render the services round the clock 24/7. Okay, so this is the meaning of e-banking. Now let us see the different kinds of services rendered through e-banking. Like we have automated teller machine and anywhere banking. Automated teller machine, that is ATMs. Okay, these machines, that means the ATMs, have removed the time constraint for the customers. These ATMs are one of the methods of electronic fund transfer. Okay, they are unmanned or unattended devices. Nowadays, we can see these ATMs at every nook and corner of our streets. Okay, so let us know how these ATMs work. Our ATM card, which is issued by the banks whenever we open an account in the bank, these ATM cards are issued by the banks to us. So that is ATM card. So this ATM card is inserted into an ATM machine. The terminal reads and transmits the tape data to a processor, which in turn activates our account. Okay, this is the process of withdrawing money from the ATM or depositing money from the ATM by the use of the ATM card. Okay, so if the customer needs money, he need not rush to the bank. He may go to the ATM for withdrawals. Not only for withdrawals, he can deposit money or transfer the money. He can get bank statements also through ATMs. Not only these services nowadays, these ATMs are used for recharging cell phone bills, bill payments, electricity bill payments, etc. Okay, so for all these services, these ATM cards are used. As far as security is concerned, the customer is assured of safety, as ATMs can be accessed only through ATM cards with a distinct personal identification number, that is PIN number. We have to keep this PIN number safe, that is secretly. We should not share it with anybody. Okay. Now, moreover, every ATM location has a security guard as far as security is concerned. Okay. So this is about the automatic teller machine or automated teller machine. Now, coming to anywhere banking. Okay. So with the further advancement of technology, the banking services to the customers have undergone a vast changes. Now, a customer can operate his account from any branch of his bank situated in India. These services are also known as core banking services. So the various services under anywhere banking are telebanking, internet banking, mobile banking, payment and settlement system, e-check. Now, let us see telebanking first. Okay, so telebanking refers to banking on telephone. The customer can inquire about his balance, previous transactions, or fund transfers between the accounts, etc. For this service, the customer can dial the branch designated number, which is connected to a computer. By dialing his identification number, the software provided in the machine will become interactive with the customer, asking him to dial the code number of the service required by him and gives suitable answer to him. Okay, so this is about the working of the telebanking services. Okay, so he can inquire in the his branch for any service required by him about his account balance or any other services as such. So the customer has the choice and facility of calling the bank at any time, and it is more beneficial to majority of the customers. Okay, so this is about the telebanking. Now, coming to internet banking. Okay, through internet. So internet banking is one of the popular modes of e-banking. It enables the customer to obtain through banks, websites, electronic fund transfer through password, electronic payment can be effected through electronic means such as e-check, card-based payments, and electronic fund transfers. The various internet banking services are real-time gross settlement, electronics clearance service, national electronic fund transfer. So let us see what all these internet services are first. So real-time gross settlement. So in this concept, real-time refers to the process of instructions that are executed immediately after they are received. Okay, the instructions are executed immediately. Then what is this gross settlement? Gross settlement means settlement of funds transfer. Okay, and thus means these whatever instructions are given to them, they are executed immediately, not later. Okay, gross settlement means settlement of funds transfer, and thus payments are considered as final and irrevocable. Okay, so in RTGS, a customer can transact with minimum of 2 lakhs to a maximum of 10 lakhs instantly. Okay, So, and this is also with very minimum charges. Okay. So this is about RTGS. Now coming to electronic clearance services, it is a mode of payment, okay, whereby the institutions make bulk payments periodically. Okay, so this scheme provides an alternative method of effecting bulk payments transactions periodically. The ECS is being offered in Department of Post in connection with the payment of monthly interest under monthly income scheme. Order ECS, the depositors have the facility of getting monthly income scheme interest automatically transferred and credited into their savings bank account on the due date at their own banks in their accounts. Okay, so this is the meaning of electronic clearance service. Now coming to the NEFT, that is National Electronic Fund Transfer. Okay, now NEFT allows the individuals and firms, that is FIRMS firms, to transfer funds from one bank to another. There is no ceiling on minimum and maximum in the NEFT. That is no limitation of money, like how we have in the RTGS, minimum 2 lakhs and maximum 10 lakhs. Here we don't have such restrictions. So any amount we can transfer through NEFT. Okay, so there is no ceiling here. Okay, and according to RBI, banks cannot levy any charges for the NEFT transfers. Okay, either it is inward remittances or on receipt of funds, no charges are paid by the customers here. Okay, this is about the NEFT transfers. Now coming to the mobile services, that is in anywhere banking, we have the third service, that is mobile banking services. So we have finished telebanking, internet banking, and the third service in anywhere banking is mobile banking. So this service is provided free of cost to all customers of the bank, irrespective of their mobile service network provider and the maker of the handset owned by the customer. So whatever connection, whether he is having Airtel connection, Jio, or whatever connection he has, or whatever handset he possesses, these services are given to the customers at free of cost. Like he can, these facilities, this facilitates the customers to know his account balance and the debit and credit transactions of the account, etc., through mere alerts. Okay, so this is about the mobile banking services in anywhere banking services of the bank. Now coming to the payment and settlement system. Okay, so payment and settlement system in India are regulated by the Payment and Settlement System Act 2007, legislated in December 2007, okay, for regulating and supervision of these payments by the RBI. Okay, so the traditional methods of payments settlement in India are like we can pay through cash, checks, electronic payments, electronic clearance services, credit and debit cards, RTGS, NEFT transfers, etc. So this is a payment settlement system in India, and it is regulated by the RBI, which is legislated in December 2007. Okay, this is about the payment and settlement system. Now coming to the fifth banking, anywhere banking service, that is e-check, that is electronic check. So e-check is one of the useful facilities of e-banking. This facility eliminates the need to prepare traditional paper check by replacing it with the e-check. E-check is an electronic version of paper check. To avail this facility, a separate software has to be obtained and installed. Special electronic check is issued by the banker to its customer. The payer has to sign the check using his digital signature. For this, the payer has to submit his digital signature to his bank in advance. So this is about the e-check. Okay, so how it works, you have understood, children? Now let us see advantages of e-banking. So we have seen so many services being rendered through e-banking. Let us see the advantages of it first. Okay, so the advantages of e-banking. So through e-banking, we have a high degree of personalization, and through e-banking, we can avail the services 24/7. That means round the clock services are available through e-banking to the customers, and fastness and flexibility in the transactions, lower operating costs for the banks, speed and accuracy, easily accessible from anywhere and at any time, leads to greater customer satisfaction. NRIs can monitor and operate their accounts from anywhere in the world. Internet banking helps in reducing the workload of their branches. So these are the advantages of e-banking. Okay, then let us see the disadvantages. So we know every technology has pros and cons like that. Though we are using these e-banking services, still we have some disadvantages where we should be little careful, okay, in utilizing these services. So like non-availability of internet with high speed in rural areas, imparting training to banking staff is a bigger challenge. Problem may crop up regarding security and reliability, resistance to paperless transactions by the customer, as they may prefer evidence for their transactions on paper. Okay, although the technology is advancing, our legal environment is not in a position to keep pace with the technology here. Now, high literacy rate in India is a hindrance to e-banking. This is the main demerit, we can say, that is high literacy rate in India. Okay, so these are some of the disadvantages or limitations with the e-banking services. Okay, so this is all about the e-banking. Now, let us proceed to another important business service, that is insurance services. Okay, so insurance is also one of the business services which removes the hindrance of risk. Business is full of risks and uncertainties. In fact, the life is itself full of risks and uncertainties. So these risks are transferred or passed on to the specialized institutions called insurance companies. Then why these companies, insurance companies, take the risk on their head? Okay, they don't take these risks of free of cost. The insurance companies undertakes these risks of loss or damage, etc., on themselves in return for certain specified amounts called premiums. So in return for some amounts like called premiums, they do these services. They undertake these rendering service like compensating them for the loss. Okay, so but according to Oxford Dictionary, insurance is an arrangement by which a company or a state undertakes to provide a guarantee of compensation for specified loss, damage, illness, or death in return for payment of a specified premium. Okay, so this is a definition given by the Oxford Dictionary. And another definition is, insurance is defined as a cooperative device to spread the loss caused by a particular risk over a number of persons who are exposed to it and who agree to insure themselves against that risk. Okay, this is about insurance of one definition. Now, again, one more definition is given here. Here, insurance is a contract whereby for specified consideration is here is premiums. One party here the insurer, the insurance company, one party undertakes to compensate the other here is the insured. means the person who is getting his property or life insured with the insurance company is called an insured. For a loss relating to a particular subject as a result of the occurrence of designated hazards. So here we can clearly understood what is an insurance here. Okay, so by these definitions and meaning of insurance, we can sum up these five principles of features of insurance. Like insurance is a risk sharing device, cooperative device, protective device, risk measurement device, payment device. Okay, so now let us see what are these means. Risk sharing device. Insurance provides protection against certain and uncertain losses. The financial loss on the happening of certain events like death, fire, theft, accident, etc. is a huge loss or risk which an individual entity alone cannot bear it. Now, this risk is equitably distributed over many through insurance. Okay, so the people who are exposed to similar kind of loss come together and join the insurance or take the insurance policies. So the probability of occurring the accident or any risk can be one or two people. Okay, so this risk is shared by all those people who come forward and pay premiums to the insurance company who are exposed to the similar kind of risk or loss. Okay, so that's why it is called risk sharing device. The second important feature of insurance is cooperative device. So it would be a stupendous task for an insurer to compensate all the financial loss suffered by insured from his own capital. Okay, so here in insurance contract, a large number of people who are exposed or subject to a similar losses, as we said earlier, losses come forward and agree to share the loss arising due to certain risks. Hence, it is called a cooperative device. Now, the next one is protective device. Insurance provides protection against all risks of loss. Okay, in absence of insurance, all losses have to be borne by the insured himself. Okay, in absence, if he does not take insurance policy, means he has to bear the whole loss by himself. Okay, so which is humanly impossible. Once if a loss occurs in the business, means he has to stop his business completely. Okay, which cannot be possible for him to bear such a huge loss. If he takes otherwise the insurance policy, it can be shared with the other people. So the insurance company will compensate for his loss and he can cope up with the situation there. So thus insurance serves as a tool of protection to the business people or any other individuals. Okay, and the fourth important feature of insurance is risk measurement device. The risks are evaluated to calculate the premium amount. Okay, to calculate the premium amount, the risks are measured here. Okay, thus insurance contracts acts like a risk measurement device. Okay, and the fifth feature is payment device. Okay, insurance acts like a payment device. So in an insurance contract, the insurer agrees to pay a certain sum on the happening of a certain event which may or may not occur. For instance, in a life insurance contract, the contingent event is death or expiry of the term of the policy. In other insurance contracts, the contingency is the occurrence of fire, marine perils, theft, etc. The payment will be made only when such contingency occurs. Otherwise, the insurer is not liable to pay any compensation for the loss. If the accident occurs, if the loss incurred, then only the insurance company will liable to compensate the insured. Otherwise, he need not pay, that is, the company need not pay the money to the insurer. Okay, now after seeing the features of insurance, Now let us go to the principles of insurance. Okay, so this is a very important topic which comes as a 10 marks question in your board exam. Okay, so insurance, principles of insurance. Insurance contracts are, to whatever category they belong, are based on the following 7 fundamental principles. They are utmost good faith. The first foremost principle of insurance is utmost good faith. Faith ante nammakam, okkaru meeda okkariki nammakam. They should have faith on each other, both insurer, insurance, insurer here is the insurance company, insured is a person who is getting his life or property insured with the insurance company. So you have to understand the difference between the insurer and the insured children. Okay, so here utmost good faith means both the parties to the contract, like insurer as well as the insured, should have faith on each other, and they should disclose all the facts related to the policy to each other. Okay, so what see, this is not like the other business contracts where they are based on the buyer beware. That means whenever a buyer wants to buy anything, he himself should make sure the product which he's buying is good and is at reasonable price or not. Okay, the seller won't disclose any facts here. Okay, he may hide some facts also, in fact, to sell away his products. Okay, but in insurance contract, each one of the parties is under obligation to make the fullest disclosure of all such facts. Okay, which may have some bearing on the decision of the other party also, whether to enter into such contracts or not. Okay, that means he can take decision whether to take the policy or not, or whether the company it will give the policy or not to the person concerned. Okay, so here both parties have the obligation to disclose all the facts. It is binding particularly to the insured. Why? Because he is in the possession of all the material facts relating to his life or property. It will be binding more on the insured. Okay, say take for example, whenever we want to take any health insurance policy and the person suffering from any incurable diseases like diabetes or cancer, he may hide the fact and he may take a policy. Okay, but later on when the mission or death or any accident has happened with the or occurred with the person, and the fact, the hiding fact, if it is disclosed with the insurance company or it came up to the insurance company, then the insurer, that is the insurance company, will not liable to pay any compensation to the person. Why? Because he has hidden the very important facts with the insurance company. Okay, when he is taking the health policy, that's medical policy, all health issues have to be disclosed with the insurance company. Then only the contract of insurance becomes valid, otherwise it becomes null and void. So this is about the utmost good faith. That means both the parties should have faith on each other that he is disclosing all the facts relating to the policy. Okay, so this is about the utmost good faith, the first and foremost principle of insurance. The second most important principle is insurable interest. Okay, so no person can enter into a valid contract of insurance unless he or she has insurable interest in the object or life insured. If this principle is not included in insurance, and if we take policy on any object or on the life of anybody, then this contract becomes null and void and it becomes mere gambling. Okay, suppose we have a family and the head of the family takes, he has insurable interest in his family members, he takes a policy on them, or a wife takes a policy on the husband, or husband takes a policy on the wife, likewise. Then if we take a policy on our neighbor, or if we take a policy on the vehicle going on the road, then that is not a valid contract. Why? Because we does not have any insurable interest on the on our neighbors or on the vehicle moving on the road. Okay, so even if we take also, it becomes null and void because nobody will have insurable interest on the neighbors or on the vehicle moving on the road. Okay, so this is about the insurable interest. And the third principle of insurance is indemnity, that is assurance or guarantee. Okay, so insurance company will put the insured in the same position as he was before the loss took place. Okay, so all contracts except the life insurance contracts or contracts of indemnity. Why life insurance contract is not a contract of indemnity means, if a person dies, the company cannot bring him alive. Okay, he cannot bring him back alive. So, but they can be, the family members can be compensated with the money. But death cannot be calculated in terms of money, nor is money any compensation for the loss of life. So for other contracts, the people can be compensated with the money except life insurance. So this is a contract of indemnity. And the fourth principle of insurance is subrogation. Okay, so subrogation. So according to subrogation, the insurer steps into the shoes of the insured and becomes entitled to all rights of the insured regarding the subject matter of the insurance after the claim of the insured has been fully and finally settled. Okay, take for example, we have a car worth 10 lakhs and we have insured it against accident for 10 lakhs. And the mishap has occurred and the insurance company has paid full amount of 10 lakhs, then the insured, that is the person who is getting his car insured, the insured, after receiving the policy amount, the insured will not have any right on the residual, or that means the remaining of his car after accident. Okay, now the whatever is remaining, the residual part of the car belongs to the insurance company. So this is the meaning of subrogation. Okay, so whatever remains after accident, after mishap, the whole thing or debris belongs to the insurance company. Okay, then the fifth principle of insurance is contribution. Suppose a person may get his goods insured with more than one insurer, more than one insurance companies. This is referred to as double insurance. So in the event of loss incurred through the risk insured against, in such cases, the companies concerned will follow the principle of contribution. Each company will contribute that proportion of the loss which the policy issued by it bears to the total amount for which the insurance has been affected with all the companies. The point to be noted here is only insurance can give protection against the risk or loss, not to earn on it. Okay, so here we can take an example and understand the contribution. Suppose a person is getting his property insured with policy A 5 lakhs and policy B 5 lakhs and the mishap has occurred and he has incurred a loss of 4 lakhs and the companies have to pay 4 lakhs compensation to him. Okay, here he has three options. Okay, option one, he can claim 4 lakhs from policy A, or option two, he can claim 4 lakhs from policy B, or option three, he can claim 2 lakhs each from policy A and B. Okay, so he cannot claim 4 lakhs each from policy A and B. Okay, so that's the meaning of contribution. If he claims 4 lakhs each from policy A and B, that means he is earning a profit of 4 lakhs there. But insurances are not meant to earn profit. They are only to protect us against the risks and loss. Okay, so that is the meaning of contribution. Now let us see see the sixth principle of insurance, which is mitigation of loss, that is minimizing the loss. So in the event of mishap, the insured against, if the mishap has occurred, the insured should take all necessary steps to mitigate the loss, to minimize the loss, as he would have been taken like the property has been not insured. Okay, so here the idea behind this principle is that the insured should not become careless and inactive in the event of the mishap merely because the property which is getting damaged is insured. He must instead act like any uninsured prudent man. Okay, so this does not in any event mean that the insured should risk his own life for saving the property which is getting damaged or destroyed. Okay, just not to be careless, he should take some minimal, like for example, the fire accident has taken place and his property is getting damaged or it is being burnt. First thing is he has to call the fire brigade, and meanwhile he has to take the help of his neighbors or family members to pour the water and minimize the loss. Okay, so that much he can do to minimize the loss till the fire brigade comes. So the insurance company will check out all these things to compensate him for the loss, but not to take risk of his life. Okay, and the seventh important principle of insurance is causa proxima. So in those cases where the mishap insured against is the outcome of a series of events, the insurance company will meet the losses only if it is definitely established that the said loss was caused directly by an event covered by the policy. For example, if we board cargo on the ship and we take the marine policy, that means if your goods get damaged due to the marine water, you can claim the compensation. But if the ship has rodents and rats and the goods are damaged due to them, you cannot claim the compensation. And if both the things has happened, then which is the proximate, means which is the immediate first cause, that cause is taken into consideration. Okay, so here first the rodents have bit the packed cargo, later seawater entered into the ship, then the goods got damaged totally by seawater. So here the insured cannot claim the compensation because if the rats or rodents wouldn't have damaged the packages, the seawater couldn't have damaged the goods. So first cause for damage of the goods is rats and rodents. That's why he cannot claim any compensation for the loss of his goods. So these are the seven principles of insurance which you can get for 10 marks in your board exam. Now let us see the different types of insurance policies. Like we have life insurance policy, fire insurance policies, marine insurance. Now let us see the life insurance policies first. Life insurance policies. Now whole life insurance policy. This policy is generally taken for the protection of family. This means that the assured has to pay premiums on this type of policies throughout his lifetime. It is also called an ordinary policy. The premiums on this type of policies will be generally low because they have to be paid throughout the life of the assured. The assured sum under such a policy becomes due for payment to the beneficiaries, that means the nominees, okay, after his death. Okay, so this is about the whole life insurance policy. Now the endowment life policy. Here in endowment policy, the policy becomes the policy money becomes due at the end of the period specified in the policy or on the death of the assured, whichever is earlier. Okay, either the death or the term of the policy, whichever is earlier, the policy amount will become due to the assured or his family members. If the policyholder dies before the specified period, the sum assured is given to the family members or the nominees mentioned in the policy. In case the policyholder survives, the endowment term till the endowment term policy, the amount is payable to the policyholder himself. Okay, so this is about the endowment life policy. The next one is annuity policy. The name itself is saying annually. So these policies are taken to get benefits after retirement. The premiums are generally paid annually for specific number of years till retirement. So the benefits are generally paid monthly or these 3 months or for 3 months or for 6 months and or annually. Okay, so this is about the annuity policy. Now the next one is joint life insurance policy. So this type of policy is taken upon the on the joint lives of people like husband and wife take on each other, generally taken by husband and wife, and the amount can be claimed by the survivor whenever one of them dies. Okay, the children endowment insurance policy. This policy is generally taken by the parents for the purpose of their children's education and marriages. The next one is group insurance policy. So group insurance, such policies may be taken on the lives of the members of a family or on the employees of the business concerned. So these are about the life insurance policies. Now the next is fire insurance. Now what is this fire insurance? Let us see. So unlike life insurance, fire insurance is a contract of indemnity. We have learned this earlier. Okay, and the insured cannot claim anything more than the value of the goods lost or damaged by fire or the amount of policy, whichever is lower. So a fire insurance contract may be defined as an agreement whereby one party in return for a consideration undertakes to indemnify the other party against financial loss which the latter may sustain by reason of certain defined subject matter being damaged or destroyed by fire or other defined perils up to an agreed amount. So a claim for loss by fire must satisfy two conditions here. Okay, so there must be actual fire and the fire must be accidental and not intentional. Okay, so now we have a different types of fire policies here. So valued policy, first one is value policy. So it is a policy in which the value of the property is ascertained and agreed upon, and the insurer undertakes to pay its agreed value in the event of the destruction of property by fire. Such policies are not commonly issued nowadays. Yes, then the average policy. So an average policy is that which contains the average clause. According to this clause, a policy lays down that if the property is underinsured, that means under, lower, the insurer shall bear only that proportion of the actual loss as his insurance bears to the actual value of the property at the time of loss. For example, if a person insured his property for 15,000, while the loss assessed was rupees 8,000 and the market value of the property at the time of loss is 20,000, the claim will be settled at rupees 6,000. That is 15,000 divided by 20,000 into 8,000 comes to 6,000. So is underinsuring his property. So in this case, the insured is penalized for underinsurance for loss 2,000, which he has to bear from his own pocket. So this is about the average policy. And the next one is specific policy. A specific policy is that which insures a risk for specific sum amount. Now let us understand, taking an example. If a building worth 1 lakh is insured against fire for 50,000, While the damage to the property is assessed at 30,000, the assured will get the whole amount of loss. Like he will get the 30,000 made up by the insurance company. Okay, so this is about the specific policy. And the next one is floating policy. A floating policy is that which covers one or several kinds of goods lying in different localities under one sum and for one premium. The premium charged under such policy is generally the average of the premium that would have been paid if each lot of the goods have been insured under specific policies for specific amounts. Okay, so this is about the floating policies. Then excess policy. When the stock of the merchant fluctuates, he may take out a policy for an amount below which it does not go. That means it will not fall below that price. And another policy to cover the maximum additional amount by which the stock may rise at times. Okay, so it fluctuates, the price fluctuates, no? Below which it cannot fall and it will rise up to a certain level at times. So the first policy is called the first loss policy, and the second policy is called excess policy. So if the merchant stock varies between 1 lakh and 1,50,000, he may take the first loss policy for 1 lakh and an excess policy for 50,000. Okay, so this is called excess policy. Then blanket policy. Okay, it is issued to cover all assets, fixed as well as current assets of the insured under one insurance policy. So these are some of the fire insurance policies. Okay, now let us go to marine insurance policies. Marine insurance. Okay, so it is possibly the oldest and the original form of insurance. It is an arrangement by which the insurance company or the underwriter agrees to indemnify the owner of the ship or cargo against risks which are incidental to marine adventures. Such risks generally relate to the ship or cargo. The cargo on the ship is exposed to risks arising from an act of God or enemy or fire or gales. Gales means strong winds. Okay, so the type of marine insurance that covers such risk is called cargo insurance. But it is not merely the cargo that is liable to certain risk. The ship itself is also exposed to same perils. The owner of the ship may therefore take hull insurance, HULL, hull insurance means ship insurance, to cover these perils. In addition to the risks related to the cargo and ship, there is another special kind of risk that marine insurance covers. So in many instances, the owner of the goods may promise to undertake to pay the freight on cargo ship to a specific place when the cargo is safely delivered at the port of destination. So he may promise that if my goods reach to the destination, then I will pay the freight charges. Freight charges are the charges for the goods boarded on the ship. Okay, so if the cargo is destroyed or the ship is lost on the way, the shipping company will lose the freight on the carriage of cargo. Okay, so it is therefore open to the shipping company to take out a policy to cover this type of risks also. Such marine insurance is called freight insurance. Okay, thus there are three types of marine insurances, like cargo insurance, hull insurance and freight insurance. So marine insurance policies generally cover a large variety of risks, including the jettison. Jettison means throwing off the cargo or the loads into the water. They may expect an imminent danger like sinking of the ship, etc. So during such times also, insurance policies are taken. Now let us see the different types of insurance policies. Okay, like time policy, voyage policy, fixed policy, floating policy, blanket policy, and valued policies. Okay, time policy. This type of policies. So in this policy, the subject matter insured for a specific period of time. It is suitable mainly for hull insurance, that is ship insurance. The next one is voyage policy. This policy is meant to insure the subject matter in transit from one place to another. The subject matter insured under such a policy is generally cargo, which is exposed to marine risk in the course of transit. Okay, then the next one is mixed policy. It is also known as time and voyage policy. It seeks to insure the subject matter on a voyage for a specific period of time, particularly such policy, mixed policy is taken. So this is about the mixed policy, both the voyage and time policy mixed together. Then the next one is floating policy. It is used by the cargo owners who make regular shipments of cargo to ensure shipment expected to be made during a certain period by one policy. A policy may be taken for a one round figure amount. Okay, such policies are called floating policies. The next one is blanket policy. It is taken for a certain amount, but the premium is paid on the whole of it in the beginning of the policy itself and is readjusted at the end of the term of the policy in accordance with the actual amounts and the risk as shown by the records of the insured. Such means a big amount is paid in the initially, okay? Then later on it is adjusted according to the shipping of the cargo, okay? Such policies are called blanket policy. And next one is fleet insurance policy. So it is designed to insure a whole fleet of liners or the steamers, okay? Such policies called fleet insurance policies, okay? Now, the Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority, that is IRDA, okay? As per the recommendations of the Malhotra Committee, the government has set up the IRDA, okay? And it was established by an act enacted by Indian Parliament known as IRDA Act 1999 and was amended in 2002. And the composition of IRDA, so the total members of IRDA are 10, okay? It consists of a chairperson and full-time members 5 and part-time members 4. So this is about the composition of IRDA. And let us see the powers and functions of IRDA. So IRDA, that means Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority, okay? So it is to protect the interests of the policy holders, to promote, regulate, and to ensure orderly growth of the insurance industry, to conduct insurance business across India in an ethical manner. Okay, IRDA specifying the requisite qualifications and practical training for insurance intermediaries or agents. Okay, specifying the code of conduct for surveyors and loss assessors, promoting and regulating professional organizations connected with the insurance, regulating investments of funds by insurance companies, regulating maintenance of margin of solvency, adjudication of disputes between the insurers and the intermediaries or insurance intermediaries. Okay, then supervising the functioning of tariffs advisory committee. Okay, so these are the powers and functions of the IRDA. So it will regulate the insurance in India. Okay, and these are some of the important questions from the second unit, which are very important from the IPE point of view. Okay, from the board examination point of view, like what is e-banking? What are its advantages and disadvantages? What services are offered by banker under internet banking? Define insurance. What are the principles of insurance? So this you may get for 10 marks question, children. Okay, very important. and explain the functions of insurance, describe the life insurance, explain the different types of policies. So this you may get for 5 marks question. What is marine insurance? What are the policies covered under marine insurance? This also you may get for 5 marks question. What is fire insurance? Explain the various types of fire insurance. This also you may get for 5 marks question. What is IRDA? Explain the powers and functions of IRDA. So this sometimes has been given for 10 marks as well as for 5 marks. So you have to adjust the answer according to the marks. So this is a very important chapter from the examination point of view. Okay, as sir said, the weightage of this unit is 17 marks children. We can expect 17 marks from this unit. So try to learn thoroughly, write all these answers, then you can learn. After writing, you can learn easily. Okay, so first write these questions, answers, and learn and revise it thoroughly for the exam. Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, Chile.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for the wonderful session, and thanks to all the viewers. Special thanks to the students. Students, in the last slide, the madam has given you the important questions. Please go through and work hard. Thank you to one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Sir?
Just a little bit of...